Welcome to this BEC podcast. My name is Rasmus Bæk, and today a former medalist from the European Championship have joined me, Ronan Labar. It's been a while.
Hi, Rasmus. Thanks for the invitation.
Yeah, of course, good to have you here. Ronan, you and I, we have known each other for quite some years now. A good professional relationship, I would say. I remember one of my first questions to you back in the days were, for how long would you continue? And it's still on the block here, because you didn't give me an answer I could actually use for anything back then, but now I'll ask you again. How long did you continue?
Well, it's a really complicated question, because I don't think that we can have an answer before it's the end, to be honest. For sure, it's getting closer and closer for me, but I still feel in good shape and taking some pleasure on court. So I won't stop in the next months for sure, but maybe I'm gonna have some new project, maybe back to men's double, and I will see. We will see in the next months.
Yeah, because for you, Ronan, no secret that there's been a bit of a shopping in the partnership for you in the last couple of years. Now, of course, playing with Anne. In the mixed doubles, then some men's doubles with Tom Kikkel, then not that much men's doubles, and a bit in and out. How has that been for you?
Yeah, it has been complicated, to be honest, but that's also life for a double player. We have to be okay with this. No more men's doubles since that Tom and Delphine are doing so good in mixed, so they are focusing on that. That was a bit frustrating for me, and we will probably start a new project in men's double to try at least with Lucas Corvée in the next months. So I'm really looking forward to that. And in mixed, it's maybe going to be one of our last tournaments with Anne, as I'm moving back to the south of France to live, and Anne is not sure to want to keep playing tournaments with someone who is not practicing in the national center anymore. So it's still in the question, but probably one of our last tournaments in mixed.
What is the why a decision of moving to back to the Southern Park?
That's something I've always wanted to do. I'm actually from the south of France, and I have been to Paris because the national center is there. But it's been like 12 years now, and I feel like it's time to go back. I'm still enjoying the badminton, but maybe the practice at the national center and the group, which is really nice with young players, I'm not in the same state of mind anymore, so I needed some change, and I'm hoping to find a good
A practice setup.
Exactly, in the south. Mm.
But Ronan, also, is that also recognizing that okay, you are definitely one of the more experienced ones in the group, and you can also see that together with Audrey Fontaine, you did good at the Europeans. That must have been one of the peaks in your career, I assume. You can now see Tom and Delphine come rising. There are some youngsters also in the men's doubles coming. Is that also actually recognizing, okay, there might be one or two shots left? Lucas Corvée, actually a good example.
Yeah, it's definitely that the young French are extremely good, and I feel that they are like trying to push me out in the good way, of course. Mm-hmm. But I still feel in the game and competing. But yeah, it's more about the like personal life. I think Paris is a beautiful city, but it's also extremely expensive. Living in small apartments, mm-hmm. Away from friends and family. So yeah, it was time for mm-hmm. the change.
But Ronan, why not just say okay? Done. I go back to the southern part. We know everybody who's been in the southern part of France know how lovely it is. I'm sure you will have enough to do. Why not just say, okay, that's it. I did this for 15 years.
Just as I said, because I'm still enjoying it. I'm still feeling in good shape with no injury. And I, as you say, as I feel I have a few more tricks, few more shots to play, and I don't want to regret anything.
Mm. 2024. I don't need to say much about that. Is that the main reason why?
It's honestly, it's not the main reason, because if it was not in Paris, for example, I will still continue as I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. I'm feeling happy on court, having fun, trying to beat the other or trying to still fight with the youngs pushing me. But of course, it's a plus for sure.
Mm. We are recording this in Kyiv, Ukraine, during the European Championships. If we turn the clock back to 17, where you actually medaled with Audrey, as I also said before, when you look from that medal until now, did you get enough out of it?
Yes and no. Just after, it was like a big dream come true to get this first mixed European medal for France. We couldn't dream of it before, and since that we knew that everything was possible, and with Audrey we had some extremely good wins after, like we beat the Chinese number 2 in the world in Denmark Open, and with the medal and then this extremely good performance, we were like, we have a role now. We have a play in the top players, but we couldn't manage to find this spot and to stay in it for a long time. That's what is a bit frustrating, and that's why also we changed the partnership with Audrey at the time. And it's a bit the same with Anne. And today we had some an extremely good start with some good wins, being Ellis and Smith, for example. But then we are not managing to be as stable as I was hoping.
What is the main reason for that? That you don't manage to do that?
I don't. To be honest, that's the big question. that's what we are all looking for the answer, but maybe some confidence. There is a lot to do with the state of mind when you are an high level athlete. Maybe some regularity in the practice, in the intensity you put, and of course, like, I also have the feeling that the fact of changing that often of partnership is not helping to build something. When you see the top players, most of them, for example in Denmark, they are playing for almost the whole career with the same players, and they have good times, also bad, but they build from that, and they fight together to come back to the top. And I think in France we need to try to go more in this way, like with long-term partnership, and that's what I hope for, like for example Tom and Delphine, or Fabien and William, for example. They are young and they have like 10 or 15 years in front of them.
They should also be ready to take the tough times together and not split up.
Yeah, I definitely think so.
Well, now you mentioned this yourself, that first medal for France at the European Mix, for you and Audrey. When we look at the younger generations now, there's very much potential. We have seen it at the junior stage. We have seen it, Tom, that female moment. What does it mean to you that no matter what, your name will always be in the history book of French badminton winning that medal? Have you ever thought about it?
Thank you. Of course, I'm quite proud of what we did with Audrey, but what I like the most is that now we have chances of medal in every category at every European Championship, and I hope that the French players will soon or in the next years be able to go for the medals in the world stage, because that's the next step, and I truly believe that that it will come in the next 4 or 5 years. Maybe it's too much for some. Tom and Delphine will say that in the next months. I think we are in the good direction, and And we will be one of the strongest country in Europe in the next years.
What is it that has changed, Ronan? Because when I look at that players like you and Brice, you are like the same age group. Then there is like a gap, and then we have a lot of the youngsters who have actually been doing very, very well on the youth level. What is it that has changed? Because it seems like something has put into place here.
I'm not sure to have the answer to that, but for sure what the oldest have done, like Brice beating the top players in the world, Li Chongwei, some top five players, and the results we also had with Audre, I think that gave a lot of hope to the young players, and they were like, okay, now we have French making good results in the international level, and we can beat them at the training sometimes, so we have to aim for the same results and even better. Mm. And that's what we are seeing at the moment. That's exactly what is happening with Tom and Delphine. Mm. They had the chance to compete with Audre and me in 2017 when we get the medals. And at the time they were still losing, but sometimes at the practice beating us. And I think they built from that. They were like, we are going to do the same and even better. Mm. That's what I think pushed this all young generation to believe, and that's what you need if you want to perform.
So you have actually helped Tom and Delphine back in the day. Do you feel that?
I feel that, but I don't like to say it.
No, why not?
Because they are responsible of their own success. Mm-hmm.
But you have also been playing with Tom in the men's doubles. And I remember seeing you guys for the first time, and I also remember one of the last times I saw you on court together. It's clearly that Tom has also learned something from you. But when you look at him and Delphine today, what is it that they have learned from not only from you and beating you and playing with you, but what is it that they have grown? Because right now, when I speak to people here in Kyiv, they actually mention these guys as some who can win the European Championships. What is it that they have learned?
I think that they took a lot of confidence. They directly understood that everything was possible, that you can beat everybody. Mm. And to do that, you need to be first of all confident on yourself, and also clear about the choices and the shots you have to do, about the efficiency you need to have on court, like not taking too much risk, but taking a bit of risk, like this ratio, I don't know how to say it. And in the French group, for example, we have a lot of talents, and the big difference is that Tom and Delphine are using everything they have in their badminton bag, like the technique, the tactic, and they are using everything at the right time, with the good timing. And some other players, they have the same capacity, technique and physique, but they are not yet at this moment when you are using it at the right time, with the good confidence and everything. And that's really small details which make the difference.
When you were in the early 20s, like Tom and Delphine are now, did you think that way, which they are doing now? And if not, why not?
When I had 20, I was so far from this thinking, from this level. Also, I entered the National Center at 19, I think, and I was like really, really bad. I like to see some old video of myself when I was 19, and I'm like, okay, Tom and Delphine have the same age now, and it's like a world difference. So I know I was not thinking like that, and I think I, growing up and having some results in few tournaments, like my first quarterfinal at Europeans was in 2012. And I think at this moment I was like, okay, you're in quarterfinal, the medal is not that far. Mm-hmm. You need to believe. But before that, I was just playing to enjoy, and that's those results which make you believe more and put more energy on it and be more serious.
Would you like to have been 22 today then? Because clearly there's been a change in the way of seeing things, not only for Tom and Delphine, of course they are also talented, But it's also a general way of thinking that might not have been here 10, 12 years ago, right? Would it have been different if you were 22 now, do you think?
That's a good question. Actually, we were talking about that yesterday with Thomas Rouxel. Like, should we have done the same if we had the knowledge we have today at 20? And I'm not sure what would be my answer, because in one way, maybe for the badminton, I would have grown up faster, but then you have to sacrifice something in return, and I'm quite happy with my life out of badminton, and I would not have traded one for the other. Mm-hmm. But of course, if I was able to do both,
yeah.
Yes, I would have.
But who
done it.
Who are ready to do that, or who are able to do that? That's the question, right?
That's the good question, yeah.
But Onang, you say that you're very happy with the life out of badminton, and of course I'm very happy to hear that. But I'm also thinking you have a lot of knowledge. You have tried a lot of things in the sport of badminton. Will you be giving that to other people in terms of players when you're done as a coach, or will we see you when you leave? Then it's done.
At an international level, I'm not sure to continue, to be honest. I think that the day I will stop playing, I won't travel that much. Maybe spend more time at home with the family, maybe kids, mm-hmm. who knows. But of course, I like to teach. I don't know if it's mm-hmm. a good word. Mm-hmm. That's actually the works I'm going to do after my career. I'm a sport teacher in France, but for all kind of sports. Mm-hmm. And in the badminton way, of course, I will try to help the young ones, but on my area in the south of France. But if some days the national team is in the south of France, why not be a coach there? But for sure, I won't come back to Paris to coach.
The city of cities, that's a history for you.
The city of Paris?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course I will come back, but that's not a place where I imagine to spend my whole life. Oh. Even if it's beautiful, for sure.
It is a beautiful city, but it is expensive and it's busy. And time is running up. Onang, Farah, thank you very much for coming.
Thank
you. As always, a pleasure. And hopefully we'll see more of you, and good luck on the men's doubles project. It will be interesting to follow you and Kobe. What that can turn out. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you to have me, Rasmus.
Thank you. And thank you for watching the BC podcast.